Alrighty. Someone can tell me if I'm sitting in the right place. I might get some feedback about that, but it's a morning time here on the West Coast of the United States, Portland, Oregon. So I'll have to say good morning, everyone, even though that might be different from where you might be living. I was telling the Labrix people, and thank you, by the way, Sarah, for the introduction. I appreciate that. I was telling you, I really love this acronym, LENS, Laboratory Endocrine and Neurotransmitter Symposium. It's really excellent metaphor, getting a lens on insights for our patient care. So we are talking about abnormal uterine bleeding, and especially, like she said, focusing on abnormal menstrual cycle bleeding. I do have some, disclosures here up here first. I do have some disclosures. As she said, I co-own a supplement company called Vitanica. I'm on several scientific advisory boards. And my relationship with Labrix / Doctors Data is they are a key sponsor of the Institute of Women's Health and Integrative Medicine. And we really appreciate their sponsorship. And Dr. Lohmann's and some of their other physicians speak regularly at our seminars, and it's been a really excellent collaboration. So I feel privileged to be working with them in this way. This is the first time I've lectured in their series here, but I have done some lecturing with their training events in Portland. So let's get on with it. What is this all about, this abnormal menses? It should really start with making sure we understand what's a normal menstrual flow. And because it's not any, doesn't have to be any one exact way, but there are some norms. Generally, if, you know, in a normal ovulatory cycle where there's the progesterone withdrawal, it's a pretty stable, pretty regulated system. And it's generally agreed that a normal cycle is between 24 and 35 days in length. And you might think, well, that's kind of a big spread, 9-10 days, but that anything in that range is considered normal. And some people might have, you know, a classic 28-day cycle for many years, and then it might change a little bit. And that's generally, we don't need to get too fussy with that. Because if it's within this 24 to 35 day length, that cycle length is measured from day one of one period to the next day one of the next period. The usual duration is 4 to 6 days, but many women have a flow for as little as 2 or maybe 7 days or so. But if it gets above 7, especially if it gets above, you know, 10 or above, you know, that's going to be too much cumulative blood loss over time, and would contribute likely to her getting iron deficient anemia. So look for that sort of 4 to 6, 4 to 7 day flow as average. Each menstrual cycle tends to be pretty similar and consistent in the amount of blood that's lost. The usual volume that's lost is 30 mils, so you can figure out how much that is, but a menstrual flow greater than 80 is actually considered to be abnormal and needs management because, again, cumulatively, that would contribute to anemia, but also could indicate that something is wrong and could easily get worse. So what is 30 mils? It's really hard to, it's basically impossible for the clinician or the patient to really know what 30 mils is. So I usually gauge that in terms of how often is she changing her protection. And what some women might think of as heavy, remind them that it's, or educate them that that's actually normal. So if someone is menstruating, you know, changing a super tampon every 2 hours or longer, for that's within normal. But if every 2 hours goes on for 7 days, then that would be heavy. But every 2 hours for a couple, 3 days, and then it starts to taper off, that's normal. Once it starts dropping below that amount, then we start to be thinking, maybe this person is having menorrhagia, too much blood loss. And then there's some emergency parameters as well. And those are things you might want to look up, like, oh, wow, if it's every half hour, that deserves urgent intervention. If it's, you know, every hour, but just for a few hours, that is manageable. So those are some things to learn in that regard, clinically. There are some usual causes of abnormal bleeding that sort of change. Each cause is somewhat age dependent, not precisely, but there are things that are tend to be happen in certain age ranges. For example, anovulatory uterine bleeding and irregular menses are pretty common during the first few years after menarche. And that's really primarily due to that immaturity of the hypothalamic pituitary ovarian axis. And that just renders it incapable of naturally responding to estrogen and the LH surge. But then after, you know, a few months or a couple of years, things get clicking into gear. Regular ovulatory bleeding is usually established within that 2 to 3 years after menarche. And if they have persistent irregular menses beyond 3 years, then that would warrant, beyond 3 years of menarche, then that would warrant some further investigation. There are coagulation disorders. They're not uncommon in adolescent women. In one study, 19% of adolescent women evaluated for abnormal uterine bleeding were found to have coagulation disorders. And the incidence was even higher if their hemoglobin was less than 10 grams per deciliter, which could be as much as a quarter of those adolescent women with abnormal bleeding. Or if there was hospitalization might be required, which would be even maybe as much as 50%. The coagulation disorders in adolescents include von Willebrand disease, thalassemia major, Fanconi anemia, prothrombin deficiency, and some other disorders as well. In addition, there is psychological stress that's quite common in that adolescent age range, and including those associated with eating disorders that they may contribute to irregular periods. Do you want me to adjust something?
I think you're one slide behind.
No, well.
This is the next slide, if you're looking
oh,
at this.
Oh, this is the
this
slide
is the current
that should,
slide.
They should be seeing.
Yeah.
Okay, sorry folks, this is the slide you should be seeing. I got things wrong. Thanks for the heads up. It's common for women of reproductive age to suffer from occasional and just self-limiting abnormal uterine bleeding, and those reasons are unclear, but the shift can be easily kind of upset, you might say. There's pregnancy and related complications. Those are common causes of bleeding in women of reproductive age, and we shouldn't overlook those. Sexually transmitted diseases can cause pelvic infections that are then associated with vaginal bleeding. We'll talk a little bit more about each of these. Abnormal bleeding can also represent endometrial polyps or submucous myomas. Although the cause of abnormal bleeding in women of reproductive age is often benign, and most of the time benign, malignancy is possible, but rare until we get sort of older. But if she's in reproductive age and obese and has a history of chronic anovulation, that person could possibly have developed uterine cancer in her reproductive years. Anovulatory uterine bleeding is also common in women of reproductive age and may be due to various causes. The most common endocrine cause is PCOS, and that can affect maybe 6-7% of reproductive age women. Perimenopausal women have an increased incidence of anovulatory cycles, and that's due to the depletion of the stores of the ovarian oocytes. And that's normal. It's normal to have perimenopausal irregular bleeding. That just is part of the definition, you might say, of perimenopause. With aging, though, now we get into, 40s, 50s, 60s, now we're talking about increased risk of endometrial hyperplasia, cancer, uterine cancer, polyps, submucous fibroids. I mentioned submucous because those are the ones that are typically associated with abnormal bleeding. There are other kinds of fibroids that are typically not associated with bleeding. And pre-cancer, endometrial cancer, those are suspect in perimenopausal and postmenopausal women with abnormal bleeding. Risk factors for endometrial cancer are obesity, hypertension, type 2 diabetes, and as I mentioned, chronic anovulation. Any vaginal bleeding that happens in a postmenopausal woman needs to be, is abnormal. Now, if she's not on hormones, we obviously need to do a workup. If she's brand new on hormones, then it's probably the prescription that has caused the bleeding that she, anything within the first 1, 2, 3 months of starting a prescription or changing a prescription is probably just due to our hormonal prescription, and we need to adjust things. But if she hasn't started a prescription, or it's longer than that, 1, 2, 3 months, then we definitely need a workup. A large percentage of postmenopausal women with abnormal bleeding can have hyperplasia, polyps, submucous fibroids. But anything a year after she stopped her last menstrual period, again, that deserves a workup. Or if her abnormal bleeding persists with her hormone replacement therapy, that also definitely needs a workup. Okay, the most likely cause of abnormal uterine bleeding, just kind of punctuating a few things a little bit more here. The most likely causes of abnormal uterine bleeding and pathologic findings in the endometrium relate to the woman's reproductive age. To diagnose anovulatory uterine bleeding is a diagnosis of exclusion. So basically, we have to rule out other causes of uterine bleeding before we can say, oh, that's likely anovulatory. And this slide here summarizes the possible causes of abnormal uterine bleeding. Complications from pregnancy might include an ectopic pregnancy or even just an intrauterine pregnancy that's got some bleeding. Spontaneous abortion, gestational trophoblastic disease, placenta previa, and retained products of conception. All those can be associated with a complication from pregnancy that can cause abnormal bleeding. The infections I mentioned, we have cervicitis, endometritis, infection in the fallopian tubes, traumas like lacerations or abrasions or foreign bodies, and of course, gynecologic cancers. Benign pelvic pathology that, again, can cause bleeding. I mentioned submucous fibroids, cervical polyps, endometrial polyps. There are polyps that you can see, and that's why it's important to do a speculum exam. Polyps right in the canal on the cervix, you can see. But an intrauterine polyp, you cannot see. And that's only, you can only know that from a pelvic ultrasound or a saline infusion sonohistogram. Adenomyosis, which is the sort of relative of endometriosis, endometrial hyperplasia, these are all considered benign pelvic pathologies. But some systemic diseases can cause abnormal uterine bleeding, even a hepatic disease, a renal disease, some coagulopathies, endocrinopathies, thrombocytopenia, leukemia, those are also conditions that can cause abnormal uterine bleeding. Certain medications, obviously birth control pills or estrogen and or progesterone can cause bleeding. Steroids, Dilantin, and an intrauterine, an IUD, whether it's a copper IUD or a hormone secreting IUD. Stressors, cigarette smoking may actually can increase the risk of uterine cancer, may cause abnormal uterine bleeding. The hormonal ovarian, this slide is kind of is a classic textbook slide that looks at the hormonal ovarian endometrial and basal body temperature changes and relationships throughout the normal menstrual cycle. So I'll let you, you've seen that likely many times before. Sometimes it's useful to refer to a slide like that. Say, oh yeah, what is happening on, you know, day 21, which is an important day if we're going to be testing hormones to draw a progesterone level is on day 21. Versus an FSH or an estrogen level is typically drawn on day 3 of a menstrual cycle. These are especially useful for fertility workup kinds of cases. So that's sort of just a very blitzy thumbnail sketch of etiologies and evaluation. But let's look at our natural treatments. And this is a little bit of an overview here. The overview really starts with, you know, even though we're talking about natural treatments, and it's important to determine the cause of her abnormal bleeding, because we're going to use different treatments if the cause is adenomyosis than we are if the cause is just an ovulatory dysfunctional uterine bleeding. So determine the cause. I can't stress that enough. Control the bleeding if it's acute in particular. Determine if it's an urgent situation or not. We want to prevent anemia. Like I said, that tends to be cumulative over time, not only from so the big issue is acute, and that can be actually life-threatening, of course, but acute anemia from acute menorrhagia. But if she has heavy bleeding each month, then we're talking about that, wanting to prevent anemia. And of course, treat the anemia. If she is a reproductive age woman, we want to restore her menstrual pattern to normal. If she's perimenopausal, based on our history and physical exam and possibly some testing, our goal is not to restore normal, because it's normal to have irregular menses if she's perimenopausal. Our goal is to have it not be overly chaotic and overly heavy. We also want to prevent additional complications, like preventing endometrial hyperplasia and preventing endometrial cancer, preventing future acute episodes, and preventing infections if that's the cause. We also have a goal, as if she's on birth control pills or hormone secreting IUDs, we might need to make some adjustments if she's having abnormal bleeding. If she's on an estrogen, a progestogen, or both, and we've determined that's the cause and not some other causes, then we obviously would need to make some adjustments. Okay, let's look at what our goals are in terms of actually intervention. So in someone who's got an ovulatory abnormal bleeding, we want to initiate ovulation. So this would be true in dysfunctional uterine bleeding or in PCOS. And our plan needs to include inducing regular ovulation and correcting the length of the cycle, especially the luteal phase. We also, and especially acutely, and I'll talk pointedly about this, we want anti-inflammatory botanicals and nutrients, because anti-inflammatories can reduce acute bleeding by about 30%. And I first learned that from gynecologists using NSAIDs and indeed that's true in the literature. Astringents slow the loss of bodily fluids and are the herbs most likely to affect tissue tone. And the concept of tissue tonification is a key feature of sort of historical traditional botanical medicine. It's thought that gynecological conditions associated with bleeding can occur as a result of poor tissue tone in the membranes and poor uterine tone, and this sort of weakness of the tissues that represents this generalized lack of tissue integrity, in this case, the uterus. As I said, that's a very historical, traditional way to speak about what's going on. And traditionally, the ability of an astringent herb to stop the bleeding has been attributed to the tannin content of the plant. So we'll talk about those. And this, again, another traditional historical concept of botanical medicine is tonification. The uterine tonics and even the emmenagogues are most likely to affect uterine tone. And it's the uterine tone, they say, historically, that's related to the ability of the uterus to function as a smooth muscle. And when the tone is normal, there is normalization of the menstrual flow. Again, historically, traditionally they would say a hypertonic uterus can be associated with delayed menses and cramping uterine planes and pains, and a hypotonic uterus is frequently accompanied by heavy bleeding and a feeling of pelvic congestion. So these concepts, I think, are important to understand in terms of botanical selection, but they shouldn't replace diagnosing the cause of the bleeding. Stress brings about a mistiming of the release of gonadotropin releasing hormone, and thus the FSH and LH and can easily lead to a lack of ovulation. And then that alters that second half of the cycle, progesterone production in particular. And that timing can be adversely affected by stress. And the correction of the mistiming can be corrected by addressing the stress and reducing the stress, and obviously helping her reduce the stress. Let's look at the role of some nutritional aspects. I want to talk a little bit about soy, flax, fish, iron foods, that's for the anemia, and the general whole foods diet. So the mid-cycle surges of LH and FSH can be significantly modulated during dietary intervention with soy protein. Plasma estradiol concentrations increase in the follicular phase through soy. And during a period of a soy diet, and this very small study, menstruation was delayed by 1 to 5 days. And it looks like they actually affect, the soy seems to more affect the follicular phase, excuse me, than the luteal phase. So it's changing the follicular phase such to more normally regulate the menstrual cycle in people, in women that you've determined that's the issue. If she has a short, like a 23-day cycle. The flax seeds, this was another, again, small study of 18 women who were cycling normally, but they were given a low-fiber diet for 3 months and then a low-fiber diet plus flax seeds, 10 grams a day for 3 months. And what happened in the flax seed group is they had no anovulatory cycles during that 3 months of flaxseed versus there were anovulatory cycles in some of the control groups. So flaxseed didn't really have any significant effect on the luteal phase progesterone concentrations, but it is enhancing more ovulatory cycles, but it wasn't measurable by progesterone levels. The basic goal of fish in the diet would be to reduce the level of arachidonic acid and inflammation, increase the level of EPA, and promote the production of those PGE3s and less inflammatory leukotrienes. So remember I mentioned that reducing inflammation can reduce bleeding. I would not count on fish or fish oils for acute intervention of an anti-inflammatory effect. But if she has regular heavy menstrual cycles, I would be using fish and fish oils to hopefully make a difference in over time in that intrauterine prostaglandin environment. And here's just a list that you can find anywhere of some iron content of foods. Obviously, you'd have to have a lot of kelp to meet those needs, but 3.5 ounces of molasses, not too shabby, and it goes down from there. So just in general, how can we, if she's iron deficient, we're not going to use these foods to correct her abnormal bleeding, but we're going to try to get more iron in her diet, and some people obviously need iron supplementation. And then there is something that you're probably familiar with called an anti-inflammatory diet, that we see the grains, the fiber, and the fish again there. And reducing saturated fats in particular would be the key to this reason to go on an anti-inflammatory diet. Here is a study that kind of might surprise you, studying 41 non-vegetarians and 34 vegetarian premenopausal women. The incidence of menstrual irregularity was only 4.9% in the non-vegetarians, and it was about 26% in the vegetarians. So the vegetarian group consumed significantly greater amounts of polyunsaturated fatty acids, carbohydrates, B6, and dietary fiber, whereas the non-vegetarians had greater intakes of saturated fats and protein and caffeine and alcohol. So why did this occur? The higher fiber or magnesium seems to be associated with increased likelihood of menstrual irregularity in this study, yet we just talked about flaxseed. So I'm probably just going to confuse both of us here. But higher cholesterol and higher protein associated with increased likelihood of menstrual regularity. So I think one thing that I would focus in on a vegetarian with abnormal bleeding, and especially a vegan, would be, is she getting enough protein? And the vegans, I would be concerned that she's not getting enough fats in her diet to actually make hormones. I think that might be the issue here that we're seeing. Higher protein lowers sex hormone binding globulin. Higher fiber can lower circulating estrogens, which has some other benefits. But we basically see lower concentrations of estrogens in vegetarians, which bodes well for perhaps the lower risk of uterine and breast cancer. But for regulating the menstrual cycle, non-vegetarians might do a little better. Exercise, you can see here the level of menstrual irregularity that's can occur in these kind of athletes. You know, the more rigorous athlete they are, the more likely they are to have menstrual irregularity, especially if they're a serious training athlete, like a young gymnast before menarche. She has a very high chance of having menstrual irregularity, because that's that hypothalamic pituitary ovarian axis is being disrupted by the stress of that level of exercise. So we're going to talk now about these nutritional supplements: A, B complex, K, flavonoids, and vitamin C. So long ago, they did a study to look at this issue of vitamin A deficiency. It turns out a vitamin A deficiency might be a contributing factor in the menorrhagia of adult women. Serum levels of vitamin A have been found to be lower in women with menorrhagia than in healthy women. In this particular study, vitamin A was used to treat 40 women who had diagnosed menorrhagia. Now, the weakness of the study is that there were multiple causes of that menorrhagia. So it could be that vitamin A works better in some causes than in others, but we don't know from this study. In the group who received 60,000 units of vitamin A for 35 days, menstruation returned to normal in a little over half of them, 23, and for a period of at least 3 months. There was also a significant decrease in the amount of blood or reduction in the duration of the menses, or both, in 35%. It was ineffective in 7.5%. Now, take note, 60,000 units a day for 35 days, so for a month, that is technically a overdose, a toxic dose. You want to be sure your woman is not pregnant before doing that. You should not do that dose in a pregnant woman or a lactating woman. Beta carotene is not what's working here. It's the vitamin A. Anything over 50,000 in a non-pregnant woman has concern. But so you might get a few people that have side effects from this dose, but I wouldn't worry about it too much. Actually, if you're more comfortable with 50,000, go for it. But again, make sure she's not pregnant and not lactating. Also, keep in mind that vitamin E improves vitamin A storage and utilization, and zinc is required to mobilize vitamin A. So deficiency of zinc and vitamin C, deficiency of protein, or even hypothyroidism might impair that conversion of carotenes to vitamin A. So you might need to look a little broader as well in this vitamin A story. I don't really think B complex is a very significant player, but there may be some people who have, if they have a certain B deficiency, that might contribute to their abnormal bleeding. The liver loses its ability to inactivate estrogen if there's some B vitamin deficiencies. Supplementing a B complex might help support the proper metabolism of estrogen and thus have a role. But I would put that low on the list. Vitamin K deficiency is pretty rare, but if they have it, then obviously they're suffering in the manufacture of clotting factors. Vitamin C has an interesting role because there was this older study, I'm sorry I don't have that reference there, an older study that just vitamin C could reduce heavy bleeding. And we think the reason why is vitamin C strengthens capillaries. It also increases the absorption of iron, so we get a twofer out of that. And bioflavonoids also strengthen capillaries and may have some anti-inflammatory effect as well. But here's where we get, the botanicals is where we really get some confidence in using these interventions to control acute and chronic bleeding. So with Vitex, also known as Chase Tree, this was an observational study quite a while ago, over 50 years ago, 126 women with menstrual disorders who utilized a nice old-fashioned delivery of Chase Tree, which is a tincture, 15 drops, 3 times a day. And they did it over several cycles, every day, menstruating or not. In 33 of the women who had polymenorrhea, the duration between the periods lengthened from an average of 20 days to 26 days. That's perfect. We've taken her from a too short a cycle to a cycle that's within the normal range, 24 to 35 days. In 58 patients with menorrhagia, there was a statistically significant shortening of that of the number of days in the amount of blood or the number of days, excuse me, which is that nice little 15 drops 3 times a day. Now, Chase Tree is not a quick acting plant. This is not the plant that we use in acute blood loss, acute, like I need to make this blood get less in the next few hours, in the next few days, but especially the next few hours or the next few days, Chase Tree is not the plant. We're trying to make a difference for the next menstrual cycle and the next menstrual cycle and the next menstrual cycle. Ginger, and I'm going to talk about a fabulous study in the acute bleeding, but ginger inhibits leukotriene formation, inhibits prostaglandin synthetase. Both those mechanisms are anti-inflammatory. We talked earlier about that anti-inflammatories can reduce acute bleeding by about 30%. So we'll talk about a dose used acutely later in this study. You can use ginger throughout the month also and try to sort of pave an anti-inflammatory path, if you will, but there's a specific dose I want to show you for acute bleeding. Now, turmeric is also in the ginger family. It has anti-inflammatory effects, inhibits leukotrienes, inflammatory mediators, but now, what about the inhibiting platelet aggregation and the promotion of fibrinolysis? That sounds contradictory to what we want. That could be said of ginger too. It can inhibit platelet aggregation, but it seems as though, at least with ginger, where we have evidence that these other mechanisms override anything about blood thinning. I don't really use turmeric for acute bleeding because we have this nice research on shepherd's purse and ginger that I'll share with you, but over time, we might see some reducing of blood loss in a heavy menses with the use of turmeric. The astringents, these are the astringents that I'm mostly familiar with that are high in tannin. So these again are those historical herbs that don't really have data on the use in chronic or acute bleeding from the uterus, but these are astringents most effective in uterine blood loss because of their high tannin content. But that's probably the most likely reason that they're working. These are the major astringent and hemostatic herbs in gynecological problems: the yarrow, lady's mantle, crane's bill, bethroot, and greater periwinkle. Shepherd's purse is a mild astringent, but it has some other constituents that allow it to help coagulate blood. It's thought that it probably works best in combination with other astringents and hemostatic herbs, so in some combination formulas, especially when there's like extremely heavy flow. A flow. So, but shepherd's purse can be used over time to affect the next cycle, and it can be used acutely and semi-acutely. And I'll share with you this recent study and the dose of just shepherd's purse for acute menorrhagia. These are historically the uterine tonics. Remember, the two categories of herbs that seem to have the most effect on uterine tone are the astringents that we talked about and now the tonics. Again, a very traditional botanical concept. Dong Quai, blue cohosh, helonius squavine, raspberry leaves, and life root. Life root is a classic uterine tonic. It's been used in gynecological causes of uterine blood loss. And that soft, boggy uterus, you might think of that as maybe life root postpartum acute bleeding, maybe adenomyosis acute bleeding. But historically, it was used for menorrhagia, but it was also used for menstrual cramps and delayed menses. And then there's the stimulants. And these stimulants or emmenagogues in women who have a delayed cycle. Now we're getting beyond the 35-day length of the cycle. And they increase the tone and help initiate the onset of menses. So these are herbs that we tend to not want to use acutely because they might actually, well, Yarrow with an exception there. There's some crossover here, but think of these more as the emmenagogues. They're going to help cause the uterus to contract and to bleed. There was a study in the 80s on black cohosh and ovulation. There's a newer study on black cohosh and PCOS. We can give it for the 10 days a month to stimulate ovulation. And you might want to check out that study. But this is an older one where it was shown, looked like it was kind of similar to chaste tree berry to help stimulate pituitary secretion of luteinizing hormone and therefore help lead to ovulation, which is a sort of background for this confirming the results of the more modern study. Stimulating ovulation, thus once you ovulate, that corpus luteum can then produce progesterone. This is also something, this was out of Bulgaria. I don't usually maybe hear about tribulus too much, but I like to use tribulus, especially in anovulatory abnormal bleeding. And I use it in infertility patients whose infertility is due to anovulation. You have to take it every day in order to stimulate this normal ovulation. There was also for fertility, using tribulus with a ovulation-inducing drug, the combined results, so just an FYI, of the two together, the drug and the Clomid and the tribulus together, had more effect, enhanced fertility than just the drug alone. This slide was just a sort of a little background on rhodiola, showing that they saw some indications in mice study that they maybe increased the growing number of follicles. But this is a study that I really go on, showing that 40 women with secondary amenorrhea, but again, the paper didn't really clarify, these were multiple causes of secondary amenorrhea, and it didn't really do a good job of identifying all the causes of those, of that diagnosis. But this was 40 women, secondary amenorrhea. They were given rhodiola, either 100 milligram extract twice a day, or some people got an injection. And that was repeated 2 to 4 times. So 2 weeks a month for 2 to 4 cycles. And normal menses was restored in 25 of the 40 women. That's really, I think, great news for a botanical in this scenario. 11 of those women became pregnant. Again, an FYI, rhodiola as in a fertility formula, if the infertility is due to anovulation, is something to keep in mind. And then here's the chaste tree specifics in terms of how It's historically thought that it stimulates the release of luteinizing hormone and then mildly inhibits FSH, so that you get this indirect ability on the part of the chaste tree to raise or modulate progesterone levels because it's stimulating ovulation. Vitex can modulate the secretion of prolactin. And prolactin is elevated. Hyperprolactinemia is a cause of not menstruating. And chaste tree can have a role in a natural treatment program for that situation. This was a study, again, quite a bit older study in 57 women, a variety of menstrual disorders causing their secondary amenorrhea, and a small percentage of them develop one or more cyclic menses. Now we get a little bit more modern, 20 women, secondary amenorrhea. And, you know, this is a lecture on secondary amenorrhea is different than a lecture on abnormal bleeding, but included them here because you can see how this Vitex works and how it might therefore have a role in anovulatory irregular menstrual cycles. So this was, I think, 10 out of 15, I made a mistake, but 10 out of 15 ended up developing normal menstrual cycles. So here's maybe a little sample treatment plan for a woman who's chronically not ovulating, thus having an irregular menstrual cycle, and she does not have PCOS, to the best of our ability to say so. I would talk to her about some nutritional things, especially if she was under eating, maybe had insufficient calories or had some version of an eating disorder. That would be a very important conversation, and perhaps referral for psychological support. Might use the ground flax seeds. I would definitely use the rhodiola, and I might even use the rhodiola along with the Vitex. So that would be just a simple sample treatment plan. You see this product here. This is a proprietary product. It's a glandular product called Simplex F. It has porcine sources of thyroid, hypothalamus, pituitary, ovary, I think adrenal as well. It's a traditional glandular intervention. The idea is to try to get that symphony of hormonal messaging from, especially between the brain and the ovaries, to kick in the gear. And I've had some success with that product over the years, which is, I've never quite forgot about some early experiences I had and have accumulated numerous cases over time where I felt like that glandular support was had a role. So what about someone who's menstruating, you know, infrequently because she's not ovulating? Again, think about the rhodiola and or Vitex, the flaxseed, the adequate nutrition. But here's where we might use progesterone. This is, in this slide, it talks about oral micronized progesterone. You could consider using a progesterone cream or a progesterone troche. But these doses of 200 milligrams for 12 days a month are in the high, you know, medium range of progesterone dosing versus the tendency of lower doses in the creams. And the 12 days a month, if she had a day one, we are looking to start this like on day 15 because we don't, but she is, not the assumption here in this slide is that she's not ovulating. So we're trying to invent a cycle and we want to stimulate ovulation. We do these things all month long, except for the progesterone, because the body in an ovulatory cycle is producing progesterone after ovulation. So if we use progesterone all month long, we would actually be suppressing ovulation. So you really need to cycle that progesterone. In a woman who's menstruating too frequently, we might use that soy to kind of delay the cycle, use chaste tree again. We might use some astringents and And definitely some ovulation stimulants, because in this slide we've determined that she's not ovulating. So we want to get that brain ovarian cycle happening with Vitex and or rhodiola. You also, I don't have it up there, but you might think about maca, especially in a perimenopausal woman who's not ovulating, has got, which is normal, but she's got, might be a little too chaotic, so we want to make it less chaotic, and the maca would likely help her with some of her perimenopause symptoms as well. And here's where you see some options. It's sort of one or the other of these, not all. So I put the natural progesterone, that would be 40 milligrams in a cream, that should say cream there. That would be a kind of a classic dose, a 20 milligram cream twice a day. Again, you got to cycle that. The higher doses in the oral form, 200 to even 400. Now, once you go above 200 in an oral progesterone, you're more likely to get some side effects like dizziness, lightheaded, that kind of thing. But you need to do it 12, you know, at most 14 days a month. You could certainly do continuous estrogen but then you still cycle the progesterone, because you don't want to inhibit ovulation with using progesterone all month long. And then birth control pills obviously can control polymenorrhea. I'm going to talk about this formula again a little bit later. This happens to be a common proprietary formula with some of the very ingredients that we've talked about to control acute bleeding. So it's a little, I think I have this slide later. Sorry, it's a little bit misplaced right there. So what about some acute interventions? We need some tricks up our sleeve here with botanicals in particular, and with hormones of different kinds possibly. So remember the astringents, remember the tonics, remember the hemostatics and the anti-inflammatories. Those are the things that can reduce acute bleeding, and we can especially feel optimistic about these in a patient who has acute bleeding, but she's what we call stable. She's not hypotensive. She's not, you know, she doesn't have dizziness, lightheaded. If she has those things, that's much more worrisome and she might need to go to the emergency room. So we're assuming she's stable. And so you can refer back to those previous slides on the anti-inflammatories, the astringents, the tonics, the hemostatics. So here's where I want to tell you about this fabulous study about acute menorrhagia with ginger. And this was, sorry, the reference didn't make it onto the slide. It's Phytotherapy Research 2015, volume 29. This was a study of Iranian high school young women. They had regular menstrual cycles, but they had a recent history of a very heavy menstrual cycle. They had no gynecological diseases. They were given ginger capsules, 250 milligrams, three times a day, or placebo. And they started that the day before the menstrual cycle started. So these were women who had a regular cycle, so you know what the day before is, and you're trying to prevent the next cycle from being heavy. And starting the day before is ideal, because that's where you can intervene with that anti-inflammatory effect. And if you get a little head start jump on that, you get the best results. They started the day before, and then they continue the first 3 days. And the level of blood loss reduced dramatically during the three intervention cycles that they did this, significantly better than the placebo group. The average decrease in the heavy menses in the ginger group started as early as the very first month. It was a little bit better the second month, and even just a little bit better the third month. The ginger group, the mean decrease in hemorrhage was almost 50%. That's fabulous. 50% is fabulous and usually plenty enough of the results. And then this was the recent study. There's the reference right there. Yay. Maybe it was on the last slide too, and I just didn't see it in that little blue stripe that Labrix so cleverly included down there. So there's the reference, yay, the Journal of Alternative and Complementary Medicine. So that was very recent, July 2018. Again, this was an Iranian study, Iranian women. They received either two capsules of an anti-inflammatory called nafenamic acid, two capsules of 500 milligrams every 8 hours, or they received two shepherd's purse capsules every 12 hours. I believe the dose of one capsule of shepherd's purse was 325 milligrams. So two capsules would be 650 milligrams twice a day. And again, the intervention started, well, in this case, it started from the first day of their menses. So as soon as they get a sign of their period and we know that they are a heavy bleeder, that's when we start. And you can do it throughout the cycle of, you don't have to do it just the 3 days. Like, those are typically the real problematic days, or the first 1, 2, or 3 days. This study, they continued it for this full 7 days. The mean decrease in the shepherd's purse group was significantly more than the placebo. And then, so this is maybe a sample treatment plan was what I intended here, that proprietary formula that I showed you. Or you could use, actually these are the options, not all together, but you could combine some things. Like you could do that high dose of ginger and bioflavonoids, or you could use ginger and vitamin A acutely. You could use ginger and the essential oil of cinnamon. Pay special note to the dosing there, because you can get a toxic dose. And then this is a traditional formula of five botanicals, fleabane, shepherd's purse, yarrow, savina, and cicale. And you see the dosing there. Nowadays, pretty much I'm hunkered in acutely on that proprietary formula, or the acute ginger, or the acute shepherd's purse. I have a decent degree of confidence in those things. You can consider this acute bleeding using high dose progesterone, and you see there the first few days and it tapers. Or this is a very high dose of estrogen. Kind of need to know what you're doing. You need to know that they're not at risk for a blood clot. These are maybe generally things done by a gynecologist. There's numerous regimens of how to use estrogen or how to use birth control pills to control acute bleeding. And then some women actually do need to have intravenous estrogen. So basically, short-term high-dose estrogen can quickly control severe hemorrhage, but you have to do it briefly, because if you continue it too many days, then you're going to contribute to the problem. So acutely, short-term, it controls the problem, and then you have to bring in some progesterone. This is a little bit tricky stuff, but I just wanted to give you a feel for how you might do that. In a less severe, less urgent situation, you can more likely use progesterone to control the bleeding. So I think that's all for today. I hope that kind of helps you get rolling. I do have a blog, drtorihudson.com. I don't really know what a blog is, but I have one, and I write things twice a month on there, articles and abstracts and commentaries. You can check out the Institute of Women's Health. Again, Labrix is a robust sponsor of that. We have 4 seminars a year, and some other things you can see there. So thank you very much. Do I turn it back over to you, or do I just...